Alright, so we start with negative 2. We know what to do by now. We know that x is just a placeholder for a number, you know, to be decided later. We decide right now for it to be negative 2. So here is negative 2 right in that spot. Negative 2 times negative 2 is positive 4 plus 1. And now the thing that x is going to be is going to change to to negative 1 now. Negative 2 times negative 1 is positive 2 plus 1 is 3. And we erase. Actually, I'm going to write this down. We first had 4 plus 1. Just now we had 2 plus 1, right? All right, next we move on to 0. This couldn't be easier. 0 plus 1.
One.
Is one. Wow. Negative two times one?
Negative two.
Two.
Mm-hmm.
Two plus one.
Negative one.
Negative one. Yay. Okay, that's all the ones I asked you to do.
Yeah.
Now, take a look at what we're getting each time we plug in the next x over, just stepping over by one in the x's. What do you notice about this number that we get when we multiply that by negative 2? What do you notice about it?
Every single time goes down 2?
Goes down 2. 4 go down 2 to 2, go down from there to 0, go down from 0 down to negative 2. What do you think? You agree?
And then, yeah.
Well, do you think that pattern will continue?
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, if I plug in a 2 there, well, that's going to be negative 2 times 2. That's going to be negative
4
plus 1. Next would be negative 6 plus 1. Next would be negative
8
plus
1.
A steady pattern. Now, did we see that kind of pattern in the other functions from the previous day?
No.
It was not a predictable pattern. And if you want to, I have it here. You can go back and look. Should be there. Okay. Well,
maybe
fine. Be that way. I'll have to go back and do it manually.
Wait.
A dipper.
This is
gonna.
Well, there it is. We can look at it there. Let's look and see if that pattern, if something like that pattern exists. Okay, the x goes up by one. This x goes up by one. Or sorry, down by one.
Five.
Okay, it goes down by five. Okay, we go up one more in the x, and does it go down by five again?
No.
No.
It goes down by
three.
Hullabaloo is about. Just please calm down. Go up one more. What does x do? Or y, sorry?
One.
There's not a pattern like the one we just noticed.
Goes down.
Now let's see what even happens in the next one. We keep going up by one on the x. It's gone down five, gone down three, gone down one. Now what does it do?
One.
It's up by one. Now it's doing back up. So, and that's fine. That's what the function does. Right? But that's not what our function that we're looking at today is doing. It's a nice pattern. Nice and steady, kind of like a set of stairs, right? Go over this much in the x, go down this much in the y. Over this much in the x, down this much in the y. Over one, down two, right? Over one, down two. Nice, steady, predictable pattern. So, let's see, 2, that would give us, so we go up 1 in the x, we go down 2 in the y, so what would that give us here?
Negative 3.
Right, we go down by 2, and we go down from negative 1 to negative 3. There it is, negative 4 plus 1, negative 3. We go up to, let's see if I can throw you off, we go up to 7.
Okay.
I didn't go up by 1, I went up several.
Negative
13.
You went up
5 times. What's that?
You went up
5 times in the x, right?
Yeah.
So our y pattern should repeat 5 times as well. Right?
Yeah.
So that means we should go down how much? If we go down 2 every time, we're going to go down 5 times.
10.
We go down 10, right? From the previous y values. We went, the x went up by 5. Right? That's 5 times we've gone up on the x. So we should go down the y 5 times. But each time we go, right, each step on the y is 2. So it should go down 10, so it should be negative 13.
Yeah.
Okay, we're just using the pattern. We can also plug in 7 to this function here. Negative 2 times 7 is negative 14 plus 1, negative 13. It all follows, it's doing exactly as we would expect it to do. We're all noticing this pattern, we all agree with this pattern.
Yep.
Up 1, down 2.
Yeah.
Okay, now let's look at how that pattern looks. Visually, we see the numbers, and we can take note of the numbers and the patterns that they're following. Let's see what the picture of those patterns looks like, right? That's a graph. Because as we've talked about the last few days, a graph is just we're plotting these numbers onto this thing called the plane. Next time I see a distraction, there may be several of you, I'm just going to pick one of you and send you out in the hallway. Whoever that person might be, who's distracting other people. All right, so we'll plot these points, right? We did this yesterday. We had like several people took turns taking control and plotting the points, right? I'm just going to make it quick. It's fun stuff, but I just want to make it quick. Negative 1, 3, 0, 1, 1, negative 1, 2, negative 3. And what about 3? 3 would be, what would that give me?
Negative 5.
Ooh, kill him. How about if I went back to negative 3? Back to negative 3, what would the y be?
6.
6?
Or 7.
7. Okay. So go to the right 1 and down 2. Go to the left 1 and then go up 2. Right? Kind of like going back in time. We have to reverse these patterns. Now let's talk about the question that comes up too often that I'm trying to really address in a meaningful way. The question is, so I have these points, how do I connect them? As I said yesterday, this isn't a coloring book. It's not connect the dots.
All
right? But then again, almost, in a way, it is kind of like a coloring book and a connect the dots because in a connect the dots, you don't just connect them randomly, right?
Yeah.
You fill in what's missing, right? And the people who make the coloring book, they help you fill in what's missing by telling you which dot to go to. But that's what you need to do here, only we don't have a coloring book publisher telling us how to connect the dots. This guy here tells us how to connect the dots. Because it tells us how to find more dots, and more dots, and more dots. We have so many dots that the shape that the dots are making together is undeniable. What shape is undeniable here?
Line.
Line.
Oh, straight.
Isn't the line a bunch of dots? Too?
That's exactly the point. Yes, exactly the point. I'm hoping everybody gets, just like Brandon is clearly getting, that the line is a bunch of dots.
Okay.
So why don't we just plot the dots? Why don't we draw a line?
Draw this line.
Why don't we just draw all of the dots that we need?
It would take too long.
How long would it take?
Infinite
amount of time. So, using my smarts and the noticing of this pattern, that for instance, if I went over 1, I go down 2. So if I go over just a half on the x, and it should go down half as much in the y, right? Half of that would be just down 1. So that ratio of over and down is the same, no matter how big or how small a move I make. If I go over 2, then I should go down how much? If I go over the x 2, then how much? Go down 4. We did it here, right? We kept the ratio of the change in x and the change in y the same. Instead of going up 1 here, we went up 5. Now we know the ratio needs to be 1x to 2y's, right? Or negative 2y's. So we kept that ratio the same. We We went up 5 x's, so we went down 10 in the y's. Keeping that ratio the same. If I go over 1, 2, 3 in the x, you need to go down how much in the y? Move over 1, 2, 3 in the x.
Oh, 6.
Go down 6. Move over 5, go down, or sorry, move over 4, go down 8. Move over 5, go down 10. Move over 6, go down
12.
The ratio stays the same for a line anyway, not for this guy, right? That's not a thing for this graph. But for this line, it is. The ratio of moving over and down isn't the same. What is that ratio of moving over and down called?
Slope.
The slope of the line. You've heard of the slope before, right?
Yep.
Of course. Talk about the slope. Alright. So I cheat a little bit. Why would I say that? Why do I say that I'm cheating right now?
Because you just
you're just using one of them.
Oh, I'm drawing it by hand. You just click on the thing. Wait, how are you cheating? So you read a couple dots and then you started going 3 over or how many over and then down.
Uh-huh.
I'm doing that over.
Why is this last thing that I drew, this line shape, how is that a little bit of a cheat?
Because it's
straight.
You know it's
straight.
Because you're not pointing all the points of the line.
Yeah. Put
any of the dots, it's just...
Yeah, to really graph this truly, honestly, I would have to just draw all the dots. Because that, as Marina said, is what this line is. It's all those dots. But we don't take the time to do it. We cheat a little bit. We just draw the shape that an infinite amount of points would make. Now, I'm going to have you do this again. You might ask me, is it going to be a line too? Right? Here's how you can tell. Anytime you have an equation that looks like this, you know it's going to be a line. Here's what I mean by looks like this. This guy looks like that. Right? This. This guy here is M, right? Just like that. This guy right here is B. It looks like an M number times an X plus B equals the variable Y. So if your equation looks like that, if it fits that mold, then you know the graph's going to be a straight line. Let's look at one that's not like that. And you tell me why it's not like that. Here's one. Does that look like y equals mx plus b?
No.
Why?
It's an exponent.
Got an exponent. And that's pretty much it.
Yeah.
It's got an exponent on that x. That's not y equals mx plus b. Right. What if I just kind of changed it and forgot about that?
Yeah.
Yeah. It does look
the
like.
Same
it was minus 4 today. So, this is not going to be a straight line, but the one that we're looking at now is going to be a straight line. Let's look at the next one that I'm going to have you work on. Okay. Oh, what's plus 1? You're right. I don't know what it's called. I'll be right there in just a second. Is this one going to be a straight line? Does it look like y equals mx plus b?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
It doesn't have a line. Would be a straight line.
Well, you would assume that's good. You can't see that line. So that's the number 3/4. Does the question is, does it look like this?
Yes.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Look, there is a number that's multiplied by x, just like m times x. Right? Here is a negative number, but still a number b, right? Being added.
So yes.
Oh yes. So we would expect to see a similar kind of pattern. We would expect to see a line when we graph it, right? So just work on this table. Okay, so move on to 2. 2 plugged in for x now. 2 over 1 minus 4. 3 times 2, 6 over 4. But here's a nice thing that happens with 2. You can simplify this fraction, 6 over 4, right? 6 and 4 both now have a what in common? A two.
Two.
So it's three halves.
Which is
four. Now, what about, well, we have to have a common denominator, right?
Yeah.
So that's 8 over 2. 8 divided by 2 is 4, right? So 3 halves minus 8 halves.
Negative 5 halves.
There you go. Positive number of halves, we subtract a lot more halves than that. We're in the negative halves now. Negative 5 halves.
So
2 and a half. Now, I could have handled this whole fraction business a little differently. I shouldn't be surprised that 6 and 4 can be divided by 2, right?
No.
Because 4 can be divided by 2, I knew that already. Mm-hmm. And I'm about to multiply 3 by 2, so is it any surprise that this number here is divisible by 2?
Yeah.
Not surprising, right? So I could, before that, I could say, well, look at that, that 2 is going to get canceled by this 2 in the 4, and I could do this thing we call cross-canceling. Not cross-multiplying.
No.
That's a 1, that's a 2, and now we have 3 halves minus 4, and as we did just a second ago.
Yeah, I'm just saying I can't sit still. Sorry.
You don't mean that.
3/4 times 4/1 minus 4.
3 minus 4.
Yeah, the 4's cancel each other out completely. 3 minus 4, -1. Hey, that's a nice thing that happened. You want to plug in 6, or should we jump right to 8?
Neither.
Should jump right to 8.
Why should we jump right to 8?
Because it's easy.
What's easy about it?
On the graph, we can
because it's divisible by 4.
Because it's divisible by 4 on the graph, we can, you know, it's easier to graph when we go to graph it. Okay, let's do that. 3/4 times 8/1 minus 4. 4 and 8.
6 minus
4. 3 times 2, 6 minus 4 is 2.
Yeah.
I'm so good at this.
So once again, we are seeing this thing called the we're seeing this pattern, right? What happens to x from here to there?
It
goes up.
Goes up 4. What happens to x from here to there?
Goes up 4.
Goes up 4.
Goes up 4. As x goes up 4, what's happening to y?
Going up 1. Wait, going up 4.
5. It's increasing, going up by?
5.
5? From negative 4 up to negative 1.
3.
By 3.
Got
from negative 1 up to 2, we go up by?
3.
3. So we're seeing this thing on the graph we call the
slope.
0, negative 4. Here's 0, negative 4. Jump all the way over to 4. Don't bother with 2. Just jump right to 4, because it's easier to graph, as Brandon said. 4, negative 1. Jump over another 4, and go up another 3. And we can keep doing that. For how long?
And forever!
All the time. And beyond!
Why don't you back up the more? I want to just make you stay here. It's just right, so stop doing it. And then I cheat a little bit by drawing this line. I'm not taking all the time to plot all those points, which is what this line is actually made of. It keeps on going and going and going. That's why I say these functions are about as simple as they get. Once you have 2 points, you know it's going to be a line because y equals mx plus b. You can fill in all of the rest of the points by drawing a line. Okay, what you're going to do these 4 problems are all just like that, but you don't have to fill in a table with prescribed numbers for x. You can choose the numbers for x.
How many do you have to do?
Those 4. No, just graph those 4 problems.
Tyler, why don't you
just draw the graph accurately? You did it.
What did it?
Oh.